Coming up on CTV News tonight, the clean-up of snow in the eastern suburbs and no GP is bad news for North Canterbury. Welcome to CTV News, I'm Rob Cope-Williams. The clean-up in the eastern suburbs is continuing after Monday's dumping of snow. It's feared that flooding from the snow melting could cause issue in the already earthquake-hit roads. We found some contractors, however, who are happy to do their bit for the hard-hit community.
Oh, it's coming along pretty good. We're trying to clear up the footpaths and that, make sure that the elderly and the people on wheelchairs and whatnot can get by and get through and, you know, don't slip over and end up in A&E. So, it's happening all right. We're getting through it. It's going to happen quite rapidly and, people will be able to start walking around the streets again, just like normal.
You get a lot of satisfaction from it. People do come in, out and say thank you very much for helping us, you know, clearing the way. It's nice to think that you are helping out people. I guess there's a lot of houses that still aren't weather tight over here, and it must have been pretty hard in the cold weather. Luckily today we've got a bit of sunshine out and things are looking up.
There's anger in North Canterbury after the 24-hour GP was canned without any consultation, meaning that residents in that area now have to drive to the Christchurch 24-hour unit.
There's upset in the Rangiora community that 24-hour GP services have been cancelled. People living in North Canterbury now have to travel into the city to get 24-hour doctor services.
The other day, my six-month-old baby boy was quite sick, and nowhere in Rangiora we could take him, so I had to get him up quite late at night, and it was raining and cold, take him into Bailey Ave to 24-hour surgery there, and you know, they're crying and upset, and it's just quite a long way to go when you wanted to get a doctor as soon as you can.
I think it's really terrible. I live in Rangiora. It's a long trip here into Christchurch, and it's just not convenient. It's not good.
Yeah, well, I think, maybe lots of medical conditions can be dealt with out in Rangiora and the smaller services rather than having to be dealt with in the main hospitals. And, it just keeps some of that backlog out of the main hospital for the perhaps more severe medical emergencies.
Local MP Clayton Cosgrove and Rangiora resident Paula Thackwell are now fighting to get a service back into the area. Mrs. Thackwell says the community has grown hugely since the February quake, with around 6,000 people migrating north. She says a 24-hour GP is needed now more than ever. Mrs. Thackwell has taken the fight to Parliament, with 8,000 residents signing the petition, which is around 70% of Rangiora.
The petition was taken up just over 12 months ago for to get after our doctors in our community. We had them for 22 years. And it was just stopped overnight with no confirmation to the local people, and this became a great shock to the community. So I took this petition up and I got 72% of North Canterbury signed that petition and spoke and said, no, we want the doctors reinstated again.
Local MP Clayton Cosgrove says there's concern for residents such as the elderly.
Now you've had for months elderly people and others facing, you know, $100 each way in a taxi to get into the Bailey Ave clinic, where they then pay their charges on top of that. They then have to get back home. There's $200 or $300 by the time you've had a GP's visit. And my constituents are entitled to a first world standard of healthcare, just as those around New Zealand are entitled to it.
Mr Cosgrove says residents are now forced to go to the Bailey Ave clinic, which is already under pressure, and he describes it post-earthquake as madness. He says the Health Minister, Tony Ryle, has washed his hands of the situation, saying it's now a matter for the DHB.
Well, the DHB is the government's crown agent. The DHB is funded by the government, and it would be just the same as if our firefighters, God forbid, left town. The government would have to step in and provide a service to replace them in the same way as GPs have got out of it for whatever reason. The government has a responsibility to ensure if somebody gets crook and needs a service that it's affordable and they can access it in their own community. That's what most of the rest of New Zealand have.
Both Mrs. Thackwell and Mr. Cosgrove says the battle will go on and says the issue affects all of North Canterbury. And there will be a community meeting held in August.
The next step is that we've got a public meeting, as I said, we're going to have. And the public meeting is going to be Monday the 22nd of August at 1:30 at the Rangiora Baptist Church. And it's open for all people, and we want to get a big variety of different people even there to speak, from the DHB to different parliament, to different people of parliament if they wish, our local doctors if they will. It's an open forum, and we want to give the opportunity for the public to be able to voice their opinions as well.
Coming up after the break, property values and good news for a cafe. Welcome back. Christchurch's property market is looking promising, with red zone residents already showing a lot of interest in repurchasing or renting. Gracie Fee with the details.
Many would expect Christchurch's property market to be in the slums, but with red zone residents cashing up, that's far from the case.
Well, since the announcements with the red zone, we have certainly seen a increase in activity of people, inquiry around open homes, and also an increase in the number of sales.
This in mind, there's understandably becoming a lack of listings and properties for sale in the least affected areas. Mr McPherson says there's also a shortage in rentals.
On the rental market, we are seeing certainly again in the least affected areas and the good homes, especially with good heating and that, there's certainly not a big selection at the moment. There are quite a lot of homes available sort of in the areas where there's still implications around services and things like that.
And even more demand is expected for rentals next year when the focus shifts from emergency repair and demolition. In the meantime, there's a lot of buyers to keep the market busy.
Now we've got 5,000 people who have who now have some certainty about their future. They are the ones that are really looking around, looking at their options. You know, some will rent, some will move out of Christchurch, and some will seek to build, and some will seek to buy.
Red zone residents will receive a formal indication of their payouts mid-August, so some are holding off in purchasing, but others who can afford it are making decisions and moving now.
The red zone really hasn't had a major effect on the rental market at this point in time. Yeah, they do have 9 months to accept a offer, and then up to another 12 months to vacate their property. So just how all that impacts on the market is yet to be seen.
To help with these choices, the Canterbury Earthquake Recovery Authority, or CERA, is holding a property expo at Addington Raceway this weekend for red zone residents making decisions to buy, build or rent. With either of these options, however, comes the issues of obtaining insurance, but it is available.
It is very much a case-by-case situation. There's a lot of, passing over from the property. That insurer has got that risk on that property. But again, they have to, each is a case-by-case. Some are managing insurance via their mortgages through their banks, and some people can get insurance.
Conditions of being able to get insurance have been added to contracts, but the big question on everyone's minds, will prices drop?
Yeah, with lower sales volume, it's hard to pick up, to get some real hard facts on trends. But in the least affected areas, and certainly in the outer areas of Selwyn and Waimak districts, we are probably seeing some evidence of prices firming.
And red zone residents are bringing more than just movement to the market, they're bringing hope.
It has had quite a positive effect, not only for those people, but generally across Christchurch, that it's a sign that things are moving forward.
There's a lot of talk about people not coming back into the city, but a new cafe that's opened in a very nice location is proving that very wrong.
Now tell us a little bit about it. You're open from what time to when?
We're open from 7 in the mornings, and Monday to Wednesday. We close around about 5, just depending. If there's people in the cafe, we just keep on going. Thursday and Friday, we do our happy hour, so we're open quite late till about 9, and we have people from the Canterbury Club that come and support us every Friday evening.
Your next door neighbours, who of course now closed, but you have a licence and everything, so I mean it's just a nice place to come, is it?
It is. I think we look after everybody the same. we have a cross-section of people that are all trying to do something towards the city, to rebuild, to get life and a heart back.
Where were you February 22?
I, in fact, was in Dunedin on my way back, but my team were all here.
Right.
And I was slightly frightened, there's no doubt. I had one of my girls on the lift, and the rest were all serving regular customers at 1 o'clock at lunchtime.
And the place was busy then?
Very busy.
What damage did you suffer?
Structurally, very little, just some minor imperfections, but it's really just contents that we lost. Crockery, you know, alcohol, you know, all sorts of supplies.
Tell me, did you think of pulling the plug?
No, not really. Mm. I suppose the hardest thing was waiting until we could reopen and knowing what the business was going to be like. So the word of depopulation has been bandied around a lot. So it was hard to know whether or not we were going to be busy enough to sustain a good business again and what type of business we would have. Mm.
With the City Council, of course, a big tenant, which is obviously a big feeding ground for you, they've been in a bit of disarray. That must have had an effect.
It has, but they've been, you know, rezoned in different areas. And again, we do build a very good, strong, loyal base, and they come back to us regularly. Right.
Are you noticing more professional people coming into the city to work?
A little, yes, in the last few weeks we have.
Now that's encouraging, isn't it?
It is, yeah. And I think what a lot of those chaps miss, or people, is they miss that networking that they normally have with other people working within the city. So we have business meetings, they'll arrange to meet here.
I bet you have meetings now.
We do. Yeah. So they arrange to meet here, we'll set up a table for them, and we know that they're going to stay a little while, do what they have to do, but we can look after them at the same time.
And that will grow. Surely, people coming back into the city, you hope?
Yes, I'm sure it will. A lot of people are putting things in place to encourage people to come back. The road access in and out is easier now. Yes. And so it's just, I think, a time aspect of making it more user-friendly.
Was it difficult to get staff?
No, my core staff stayed with me. Some did go on. Not so much the fear of the building, but just circumstances. Mm-hmm. People need to work. You know, they like to work on the whole. So I was very lucky. My core staff stayed, and we've just taken on a few new faces.
Are there still some of your old chums that don't come in, and you think, I wonder where they are?
Yes, yes. There are people that we haven't seen, and I feel that in time we will. Mm. But that will be for their time. It's everybody has a personal feeling, and you have to be happy to be here. And then not only just be in the city, but back in a high-rise.
Now, weekends not applying at the moment?
Not at the moment. We just let everything sort of settle down a little. Yeah. And once we're open, we can't open and close at our whim. It needs to be consistent, and our customers need to know that Saturday and Sunday, if they're coming here, it's going to be open.
How long have you been in the hospitality industry?
Not that long.
What got you into it?
Oh, just lots of things. Services has always been something I have done. I'm an ex-nurse, worked with British Airways. I've done management. So it just seemed to be a natural step. I like my coffee. So.
And Christchurch is home?
No, Dunedin is
Dunedin
my home.
Dunedin's home. Oh, well. Yeah. So's the owner of CTV, of course. Yeah, very proud Dunedinite. Yeah.
But wherever your roots are for the time being, it's always home. Yeah.
And you're enjoying it here now.
I am. Yeah. And we look after people that enjoy being here as well, right. So it makes it a nice place to be.
And your day will go more quickly if you've got contact with people, doesn't it?
It does.
It just seems to be that way. Instead of navel-gazing, it's nice to be hearing other stories.
Yes, and the customers talking to amongst each other, and also the tenants, they all come in, they have a coffee, there's that hub of meeting, catching up with...
So you've noticed a change in the mood of Cantabrians? More willing to talk to each other?
I think so, more open, more relaxed in that sense. People like to hear other people's stories, and I think that gives them heart to move on as well.
Yeah, that's part of the healing thing, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah. Christine, you run a wonderful establishment, and it is the Club Tower Cafe, and I think you're a brick. I really do.
Oh, so well, thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, it's not all dead and doom and gloom at all. Come into the city. There are people here doing splendid work, and you know, we recommend that you do come into the city. And if we can encourage the habit, then the city will grow.
Welcome back. Well, posties say that the mail must get through, and it would seem as though it's at all costs because of the icy conditions.
Christchurch posties have been skidding and sliding on their bikes today after post resumed, having been out of operation in Christchurch since Monday. The snow and icy road conditions have caused a lot of disruption, and Christchurch postmen now have a huge load of undelivered letters to slip into letterboxes, residents eagerly awaiting their arrival. One postie had to return to his sorting office when he found the roads were too treacherous and dangerous to bike on. He said sorting mail between addresses while biking along made it even more difficult to stay on the bike. One postie had fallen off and allegedly injured himself around lunchtime today. Canterbury delivery business leader Duncan Berman said Christchurch had a backlog of around 120,000 items of mail to be delivered. He said there was limited delivery yesterday and all posties were out on the roads today. However, if they found footpaths were too unsafe, they would avoid those areas. That meant parts of their deliveries would be missed. The hill suburbs posed a problem, but mail was mainly delivered by foot. Mr. Berman expected the backlog to clear in the next few days, but until then, posties would be working very hard to get letters to their destinations. The NZ Post call centre had received quite a few calls from concerned residents over the past few days, unsure what had happened to their mail, but he said you just have to walk outside and see the ice on the footpaths to know what's going on.
Now here's Emily with what's on for your looming weekend.
Hi everyone, welcome to What's On. Now I've managed to pick up a cold from this cold weather, so please try and bear with me. Firstly, this weekend the Lyttelton Harbour Festival of Lights is on in Lyttelton from 6 until 10 p.m. Friday night. And the community hopes this will send the message that Lyttelton is still thriving. This Friday night we'll also see Penny Ashton's one-woman comedy show come to Christchurch. Her show is on at Paparoa School Hall. Penny sold out shows from Edinburgh to Adelaide and she's represented New Zealand as a slam poet. Also, the Canterbury Celebration Theatre in Avonhead is holding a number of events this weekend, including Vegas, starring Tim Beveridge. And just a reminder that the Papanui RSA market is on at the RSA car park every Saturday from 8 a.m. until 1 p.m. and more stall holders are more than welcome to come along as well. There's also a rebuild Christchurch Expo on at the Addington Events Centre this weekend, and the theme is My Housing Options Sarah Expo. This will be held on Saturday from 12 until 6 and Sunday from 10 until 4. Entry's free and there'll be seminars on building, renting, buying and organising insurance. And of course it's the school holidays, so there's various Kids Fest activities on at Hagley Park. You can visit the City Council's website for more information on what's happening. Now, if you've got any events you'd like us to mention, you can email me, emily.cooper@ctv.co.nz, or you can call us here at CTV on 377 033. See you back here next week. Hopefully my voice is back.
Gracie Fee hit the streets on Street Talk today to find out how people are handling and what they're thinking about high food prices.
Quite a topical issue at the moment is food prices and how outrageously expensive some items have become. I know myself, I love food, and I'm keen to find out whether other customers have found these price hikes quite ridiculous.
I need to cut some bread or milk or dairy products like yogurt.
So it's fair to say some families are finding it quite tough and struggling at the moment.
Yeah, I think so. Yes. And we have two kids, so they have lots of yogurt and milk that we need, but we need to think about buying and choosing very carefully when I shop.
Even our bread's there, cheese is there. What else? Milk there. I don't know why. Yeah. Meat very dear. Too dear. Yeah.
So you maybe go to the mad butcher a wee bit.
Well, we do. I actually go to the mad butcher for pork. They're cheapest.
So you've got to buy the essentials, but. Bargains, if you buy them as you go along, well, I think that helps, It sort of keeps the grocery bill down a little bit on that way.
It's very expensive. Yeah. My shop there just cost $160 and all I got was 3 nappies, formula, only a bit of fruit and veg and some sausages.
Just the bare essentials,
yeah,
really?
Yeah.
So you've kind of had to cut down on luxury items tomatoes?
Yeah, or tomatoes are too expensive, $10 a kilogram at the moment.
We're okay. We're certainly watching what we eat and planning our meals a bit more than we normally would, but yeah, it's okay.
Saving to budget and cut down on more expensive items?
Yeah. Certain things are out of the question, but yeah, it's all good.
Yeah, things like cheese and that kind of thing. Everything seems to have gone up.
Even bread and everything. Are you choosing more budget brands?
I'm choosing more carefully when I go into the supermarket, definitely.
Can you see them coming down anytime soon?
It would be nice.
a lot more affordable.
We're great.
Extremely expensive, yes.
And you're having to, say, not buy tomatoes and all those luxury items
of
that
course.
You usually have.
And look
yeah,
for
no,
all the specials.
The tomatoes.
No,
Way
no.
Too expensive.
I'm glad I haven't a family to bring up.
Yeah, exactly. With all these young families, they can't really afford much. Are you having to budget a lot more?
Definitely, yes. Yes, it's got a lot harder.
What about the choice of supermarket?
Coming from Oamaru, I don't have much choice of supermarkets.
So Oamaru's got a bit of a monopoly going on, really.
Yes, that's right.
I'm Rob Coate-Williams, and that's your news and weather.
Supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand On Air.